And I'm doing it for quite a long time. And today, but in this appear, this is also flourish the Lord. And appear the Lord of new connections with other branches of representation theory. So what I plan to do is basically I should divide my mini course in three parts. And the first part will be about finite dimensional representation theory. Basic classical constraints of algebras. And this part will be mostly algebraic, and all you need to know is basic representation theory of simple real algebras in characteristic zero. So, but however, even this theory is rather complicated, and I hope you will see connections with such previous lectures, because many things for these super algebras are similar to characteristic PKs. Then I want to talk about super geometry and geometric methods. Basically, there are two things which I want to cover here. The first one is variable theory. And here I will talk about algebraic super varieties. And even mention, it may be a little bit touch localization. Basically, why it doesn't work. But localization, I mean, appearance of the theorem, classical setup. And my third part is concerns more recent results, which relate to duality and categorification. And it also might be related to tensor calculus. So before I start, I would like to mention that there are several of these recent books on the subject. For a long time, there were no monographs, more or less. But now we have several textbooks which cover different aspects of this subject. Maybe I mentioned three. So on algebraic aspects, there is a book of Ian Masson. These super algebras are involved in algebras. On super varieties, we now have a book by Kameli Kastan. Here it is. Mathematical foundation of symmetry. I also would like to mention an earlier mining book. Some chapter of it is dedicated to flat supermanifolds. It's called H field theory. Conference elementary. And about duality, there is now a book by Cheng and Wong. Which is called Duality and Representations of Human Love. So I would like to ask if I press the chalk enough. Could you read what I read?
If you press it more, then.
Again, this is almost all scrap. Okay, so so what I'm planning to do today is actually to give an introduction to these super algebras. So it's not going to be very recent. And basically, for example, I think that Victor Kask, who started this, shouldn't be on this lecture at all, because I don't think I'm going to say anything you don't know today. And the modules are also supposed to be graded modules. So the first example, let us talk about vector space. Dimension is a true number. first number is dimension of V0, the second of the dimension of V1. And if we choose basis here, so it is a homogeneous, so the first M elements are basis in V0, and the second M basis in V1, then we can represent this algebra in matrix form with the block matrices A, B, C, and D. The size of this block is M by M, and this one is M by M. And so this is an associative supergraph. So now, if I want to proceed and build the theory, you just have to be pedantic and follow the full ensemble. So I'm going to write down the rules of the game.
Sorry, this is E n plus n, right? The last
E
bracket.
N plus n. Thank you very much. So let me write down the rules of the game. Written for homogeneous elements only. And then extend by linearity. And here, maybe I forgot to give you a notation. If A is an element, say, superalgebra, by A bar, I denote a parity or degree, usually called parity, A. So my second part of this game is that, so every turn, there's a special sign coefficient to calculate the sign coefficient. You follow the sign rule, which says whenever you one term is obtained from another, by switching, by swapping, x and y, when the term which appear, the term coefficient will be minus 1 to the power which is the product of parity. So here is an example.
Your x means what? Swapping x?
X and y. Swapping x and y. There are two variables.
Swapping x and y. What do you mean swapping x and y?
I will show you an example at home, okay? Just let me give you an example. So you want to define the supercommutator.
If you have a permutation, you multiply by sign?
Yes, you multiply not by the sign, by the minus 1 to the product of parities, x and y.
It's more clear
if I do it by example. So what you do, in the usual case, write down xy minus yx, right? So now you look at the classical formula and you see that here I switch x and y. So I'm going to put here minus 1 to the product of parities of x and y. One can do it more formally in the language of tensor categories, and I'm going to talk about it later, but I don't want to talk about it today. Just going to say that if you are pedantic and follow this rule, it never lets you down. Everything is going to work out. If I want to define now a supercommutative algebra, then there's of course the algebra which satisfies the identity x, y equals a supercommutator of any two elements must be zero, but again, any two homogeneous elements. You can define a free commutative algebra in this case, and suppose your commutative algebra, consider a pure free supercommutative algebra, with odd generators. Psi 1, psi m. So what you have to do should be the all psi 1, psi n are all odd, for example. So what we are going to get as an easy exercise is going to be the Grassmann algebra. It's going to be finite dimensional. The Grassmann algebra psi 1, psi n, and it is a finite dimensional algebra. So as one exercise of application of this rule, let us define the adjoint linear operator.
Yeah, before you raise. If you don't require commutativity, so super algebra is the same as algebra, right?
Plus z to grading. And if you consider ideals, if you consider ideals, they are super z. And one thing which I forgot to mention, if you decided to study homomorphism in algebra, they should be your friends.
Sorry, could you repeat that last point? You said you forgot something, and could you repeat the last point you said already?
Come over.
Homomorphisms between algebras, modules. In order to have an abelian category, which we want to do, we want to preserve parity.
The grading on this star?
In the same way. I defined it on endomorphism.
Okay, as an endomorphism. Okay.
This is because at home I'm
and k way. Is degree zero.
Yes, of course, okay. This guy is degree zero.
Okay.
Okay, so I choose a basis like this here, mm-hmm. and then I choose a dual basis. Exactly the same way. Start. So the transpose matrix is the matrix of X star in the dual basis, right? So check when I'm super case in practice. Given by the matrix A, B, C, Z, then X transpose, you'll have a nice minus sign. Find like this. Simple axis.
So, we are. I think you said that if you don't require permittivity, then super can be forgotten.
I didn't say this. I said you still remember Z2 grading.
Yes, but here it looks like something changed when you said super reference space. The duality is...
I don't understand. I'm sorry. I don't get your question. Sorry. I think anybody else understand what does it mean? Yeah.
I mean, that's okay.
I'm not talking about
you. You are.
Come on.
I have another question.
Yes.
There's a minus sign before the transpose C, but not before the transpose B. Only C, not B.
Only C, not B. Yeah. Little exercise. Exercise number one.
Okay.
In particular.
Number two.
There was first exercise.
Grass.
Ah, okay. Okay. So just one of him. Before I proceed, this is so I do have a canonical identification. And I also have a map. So now I would like to define the trace of that character. Going to be the super trace. And I start with X, which is sitting here. And when I do the switch, because I want to map this one to this star, then the V. And when I consider the switch, I should apply the sine rule gain, right? Because if both of these guys are odd, when I do the switch, a minus sign appear.
It's not better. What is the parity on this star?
Huh?
What is the parity on this star?
Oh, I already asked somebody. The star. Okay, home. V to W always has the grade to grade.
No, no. Okay.
Right? So, zero par are the operators which preserve parity, and odd par, those are operators which shift parity by one. Okay, so what I do here, I have to use my super rule again. Okay, so when I do this, and when I go to my ground field, right? So in this way, I can associate to the linear operator X number, which is a super trace. So the exercise. Yes, check that if X is in the matrix form as before, then the super trace of X is a trace of A minus 3 of d. And check that the super trace of a super commutator is 0.
Where the super trace is defined by this rule.
By this rule, exactly. So what I'm trying to, the message I'm sending is that if you follow pedantically the sine rule, you get all the formulas. And you get the sine where it should be. So now we are going closer to the subject of my talk, which is least of your algebra, and let me start with giving the definition. We're just going to do the classical case and put the sine rule. It is cosymmetric, but with the sine rule, some particle of x and y are odd when it becomes a symmetric operation. Some question?
We were thinking, what is the last map? It's just the evaluation map.
Yes,
right?
Evaluation map.
Okay.
Right, evaluation map. So the second are the Jacobi identity. I'm going to write the Jacobi identity in this form. Derivation, or just the derivation. I have an associative algebra, So one particular example is that if I take endomorphisms of me, the dimension of me equals mm, then endomorphism of me is now a Lie because it's associative algebra, it's also a Lie super algebra, which is going to be defined GL and M.
The second example is a special case of the first
one. Exactly. No, this is not the second example.
Oh, okay.
So the second example comes from derivations.
G1 is a G0 1.
know what? Now, if I look at the bracket of G1 to G1 of G0, it is actually approximate the second power, because as we discussed before, the commutator on the lower part must be symmetric. And this must be a homomorphy of G0 module. And the last condition, let's check it quite easily, is that for any x in G1, the commutator of x with x, and once again with x, is 0. So this last condition is taking care of the Jacobi identity for when in the Jacobi, in the triple commutator, all turns out. So now let me give you an example of a small simple central algebra. It says OSP 1, 2, and its dimension is 3, 2. So I'm going to define the commutator in these terms over there. So G0 is SL2, and G1 is the only two-dimensional representation. So what I have to explain only, what is the commutator of G1, and so if you know a little bit of representation theory of SL2, you know that the second symmetric power of V is isomorphic to the joint representation for SL2, and this is exactly the remainder. The remainder. Okay, so I can have which comes from representation 0 of SL2. Okay? So in order to, for the sake of motivation, I'm going to show you one nice example where this superalgebra appears. So this example is actually due to Joseph Bernstein.
And the last condition is example is obvious. This last condition, XXX.
Oh, you have to check it yourself. I mean,
it's
okay.
An exercise.
It's an exercise, yeah. I'm not going to check it. It's easy.
But it's not obvious. One is to check.
No, no, it's not obvious. I see. I don't see how obvious.
And then since omega, I can go to take the zero,
the pi vector,
and I can take the contraction on omega, which goes in opposite direction. So that's well known fact that omega and I omega and their commutator give you SO2 action. So now I would like to extend it to the action of OSP12. I cannot do it directly. What I have to do, I have to assume that M has an additional structure. M has a wine bundle. With connection. Such that the curvature of this connection is proportional to omega. And instead of considering just the Durand complex, I'm going to consider the twisted Durand complex forms.
Delta number connection, yes. Omega is equal to?
Omega is the curvature times some constant.
It's
omega is proportional with non-zero coefficient. Okay. So if the bundle is trivial, if the connection is flat, then it has this one. I don't get OSP12 action. But if it is not flat, and consider this complex, and there I have also the iterator number of degree one,
the degree comes from omega.
Degree comes from omega. About it, this is actually, if I look at omega, if I look at this thing here, this is a Z to greater space, a Z greater space, and therefore a Z to greater space, of course, right? And now I have an operator of degree one, and then I have a dual operator. And those are odd operators, because they shift degree by one.
Yeah, so we say operator. These are vector bundles.
And say take sections over something.
Sections.
Say sections, yes. It's a sections over any action on the shift, right? And so the point is, and this is an exercise too, that omega star, now star, and degree operator, and the gradient. Generate a super algebra. Then the super algebra is a module. So I don't need this example in what follows. I just want to show you that actually in topology, so the super algebras are not only important in physics, which quite clear, they're also important in geometry and topology, because some small superalgebras naturally act on some complexes.
Here, in this example, you have t is not equal to 0, right?
It's h, and h is not equal to
0.
I already said it.
If h is equal to 0, I still get the super.
Yes. What I get if h is equal to 0? That's my question. What happens if?
So omega is zero? It's probably
that's okay. A flat connection. So you get a super algebra, but it would have the three trivial commutator on if between odd elements. Mm-hmm. Actually, it's very important superalgebra, since he asked me. There is a paper of Olivier Mathieu who uses exactly this superalgebra, sort of the degenerate, if we want to. Mm-hmm. He proved that the Hodge theory doesn't work for symplectic manifolds, using representation theory of this degenerate superalgebra. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to say that they are useful in some other ways. Okay, so I think it is wise to make a break now for 5 minutes.
7. Sure.
Okay, so during the break I had 2 questions. So first, some people asked me, what is the grading operator? The grading operator is just the operator which multiplies the form by its degree. And the second question, I didn't explain how we construct only the star here, because it's unclear a priori that there is no duality of this complex. So, for example, you can define Nabla star just by the super commutator of omega star and Nabla.
What is omega star?
And omega star is contraction.
Contraction is what?
Which is formed during the omega, the pi-f.
Omega contraction with inverse omega.
The pi vector, omega star. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about simple least superalgebra. And from now on, I'm assuming that K is characteristic zero and algebraically closed. So there is a lot of interesting questions still open even in such a simple case. So first, I think it's really important point in the whole theory what happened in 1977 when Victor classified simple least superalgebras. So I'm going to review this classification. Okay? And this classification, in a way, should say that there are three types. So the one which people call basic, and those are classical and exceptional. Then we have the ones which are called strange. And they're really strange because they don't have analogs even in characteristic case. And then there are Cartan. So the definition of basic algebra is the algebra G, super algebra G is basic. If G0 is reductive. And in addition, G has invariant. Even symmetric form. That means that we have a form. Like a penny, and on the zero pairing only the derivative and order. So this is the form. And those super algebras are called ways. So strange super algebras is probably the most important one in a way. And I'm going to talk about them later. And just write down that there are two of them, and I'm going to explain who they are later on.
You can also, I suppose this is equal to zero, right?
Oh, it goes to zero.
You can also write it without this sign.
But I can. Yes, I can.
Just putting y on the other side is zero. Right?
Yes, it's because it's evil, right? I can write it down.
Because it don't permit the thing. No, equals.
Equal x, y, z.
Okay. I'm just
I sort of thought that it's more consistent.
No, equals. Equal.
No,
equal.
Minus.
Okay, so that's equivalent. Yes, these two things are equivalent. And the Cartan type, I give you just a glimpse of that. I'm not going, I don't have time to talk about this algebras much. But those are one you already know, and this is W0M. Derivation of the Grassmann algebra of n variables. And some subalgebra. It's also a very interesting topic, but probably I'm not going to do that. So here we still have reductive equal part.
You take 0n because if you do mn, it will be three-dimensional.
Exactly, right. Of course, I can consider a free commutative ring with m even variables, even generator, and an even generator, and then I get infinite dimensional algebra. But since I'm talking only about finite dimensional, I just have to put 0. So today I'll probably only talk about this one. And I'm going first to define them for you.
When you say simple, it means it doesn't have ideal, graded ideals?
No graded ideals. All ideals are graded. Everything is graded. It's very important. Now, what happens if m equals m? That's exactly what is happening. happening here is makes all the theory difficult. It's just that in the usual case, this theory of simple Lie algebras works so well because the trace of the identity operator is not zero. But for example, if n equals n here, then the supertrace of the identity operator in the space Mn is going to be zero, right? And therefore, the identity matrix lies in the cell Mn. And so the center of the cell Mn, I'm going to use such notation, little z, for the center of the superalgebra. And being crazy for a certain universal self-analysis, which is going to be related, right? Therefore, I have to caution, and I should take the algebra PSL MN, which is a caution of a self-quiet center. And this one is simple. If n is greater than 1, maybe we should look, and just to be more familiar, let us look what happens if n equals 1. When we have a sum 1, and the basis, which is we call xyz,
the center is just the identity.
Center is just the identity. Identity matrix lies in SL. And so I have the quotient play. And as soon as n is big, as n is greater than 1, I get a simple one. But for a cell 1-1, let us see what I'm going to get. So we are looking at the cell 1-1 now, right? So I do have x matrices of this form, z, y, matrix of this form, and z is the super commutator of these four matrices, and so it's going to be just a homomorphic matrix. So what I get is a super analog of the Heisenberg algebra, fx1 commutator of z, c commutator of x, c commutator of y. So if I quotient by the center, I just get something like here, right? Just an abelian, zero two dimensional super algebra.
Implies x1 plus y bar.
And so we now consider the subaltern of elements in GL which preserve the form. So it's V W plus minus 1. So what kind of a superalgebra is this? So let us describe it in terms of G0 and G1. So the G0, or the linear operators, which preserve the form of symmetric form of the zero, but my form, so look what you have here, the form restricted only one becomes symplectic, right? In the English sense. So therefore, if you want it to be non-degenerate, V1 must have even dimension. Now, if I look at G0.
But O span 2n is when you take a special symmetric form, right? This is O span V as you define it, isn't that right?
Isomorphic.
I know it's isomorphic, but.
Okay. So Rita is right. So if we work not over algebraic closed field, there is more than one form, right? Depending on the field which we work. Since we work over algebraic field for characteristic zero, here we only need that it is algebraically closed, and I try to classify all such form. So what is this form? It's just a symmetric form on V0 and skew symmetric form on V1, and non-degenerate are all equivalent or equivalents. So therefore, everything depends only on dimension. But if you want to do it in canonical way, you can define all skew of V in your observatory. So now what is G0? This is the algebra which preserves form on the zero, which is symmetric form, which is all there. And it is the form which preserves the symplectic form on V1, and this is SP, 2L. So the two different series which exist in the classical theory come together into one series for superalgebra. So what is G1 as a module? So I'm not going to write it down. I think it's a good exercise. If you never worked with this algebra, is to prove that G1 is isomorphic to the V0 tensor V1 as a G0 module. So now I would like to mention something. Well, there is a little bit of difference between these two examples. If we go back to example one and study, for example, SLMN and also figure out what is G0 and what is G1. So let's go back to this example.
What is V0 and what is V1?
This is my idea. So this is just the standard representation of over M, and this is the standard representation of SP to M. Okay? And you can actually construct the action for this, right? You can actually construct the action as a linear operator on V. But this is an exercise. So let us return to the previous example. And let us check what is the zero part of SLMN. Zero means that it's A.
plus SLM plus one dimensional set. Okay? So this one dimensional center happens to be center of the whole superalgebra only if M equals N. So now if you look at G1, it's two pieces, right? U0 and U1, again. So the dream. So I do have a gradient. One is Z gradient. Which was called consistent gradient, so this is even, and those are odd. Okay, and they are, let's look who they are. G1 is matrices of this form. And G negative 1 is matrices of this form. And you can see that G1 is isomorphic to V0, tensor V1 star is a module over G0, and G minus 1.
So you're considering SLMN?
SLMN, and I'm saying that the SLMN now has a Z gradient. Not just Z2 gradient, but Z gradient. But it is compatible with Z2 gradient. And in particular, the call G1 is the sum of G minus 1 and G1 in this gradient. And so it has two reducible components as a module over G0. Okay.
So you have some clash of notation.
Yeah, yes, I'm confused about
yes,
what
is
G1
now.
I
know, but
maybe in brackets or yes. Yes. Thank you.
Okay. So G1 is
the G0 you could put it in parentheses or without parentheses.
It doesn't matter. So I will read this condition and allows one to divide this basic classical superalgebra in type 1 and type 2. But before I proceed to this, let me give you one exercise. Let G be a simple superalgebra. Prove that the center of G0 is at most one dimensional. So this, if you have type 1 superalgebra, they, the one which allows this kind of so in this case, G1 has two reducible components of the zero order.
Wondering if G is a simple superalgebra or simple basic superalgebra.
Any simple superalgebra.
Ah, any simple, thank you.
So maybe I need reductive quad, I'm not sure. What reductive is zero?
Let's put what we got to zero. Maybe. Okay, so G0 is semi simple. And G1 is an irreducible G0 model. So you can check that PSLMF is of type 1. But also OSP 2, 2M. So if you look at OSP 2, 2M, it's even part. It's after O2 plus SP 2M. And O2 is a bigger algebra. So this is also type 1. So all others are of type 2. It's OSP and the exceptional guys, which I'm just going to do. Maybe one more exercise before I. So, why I should make the distinction between type 1 and type 2? So, if you think about symmetric paths, if you work with symmetric spaces, for example, there you just have a usually algebra. And you have the involution. And then you have two types of symmetric spaces. One of them are Hermitian symmetric spaces, and the one of the others, right? And Hermitian symmetric spaces are nicer. For example, they usually have complex structure. And in a way, this dichotomy type 1 and type 2 here is in the similar way. So certain things are much easier to prove for type 1 than for type 2.
A Hermitian superspaces occur in both types.
Yes, but I'm just saying about analogy of usual even case. Okay, right.
Yes, I have a question. So when you divide in type 1 and type 2, are you talking about simple superalgebra?
Only about simple basic.
About simple basic.
Right. Actually, about any superalgebra with deductive even part.
Okay. But is it obvious that G, say, this grading G minus 1 is simple, general, as a G0 module?
No, but it's true for simple.
For simple, okay.
For simple.
Well, I don't understand your analogy about Hermitian spaces. I don't understand it.
Okay. So let us look, let us take the symmetric space and complexify it. When you have a symmetric space, and you have G equals G0 plus G1, when you have two different situations.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the one, when you actually have the gradient, so G1 plus G0 plus G minus 1.
So G0 is your compact in right. The analogy.
Ah, yes.
Okay.
So, and I promise, I'm not sure if we will see today, but certainly we will see next time why type 1 is sort of easier to deal with.
Is splitting of type 1 and type 2 is part of the exercise? You're not going through it.
Probably no. But it follows, for example, from classification case by case. In a moment, I gave you the list, right? Already, of classical. Now I would like to talk about exceptionals because they're beautiful and have some surprises. By the one-dimensional center. So we have an exact sequence of superalgebras like this. And this is not speed, so you can maybe exercise, check what happens. So the next surprise is that sometimes simple least square algebras have deformations. Since we know this small isomorphisms, this is just SM2 plus SM2 plus SM2. Okay? And the corresponding OSP for P1 is P1 plus SM2 plus SM3. So maybe I give you numbers for the code. Okay, and so we are is two dimensional. Representation of SM. Now, as we discussed before, when we discussed SL2, we do have for each I one, two, and three. We have a form, symmetric form of Vi, so we have then one and 12 from number two, Vi to K. So two I, one and four. And we have a map, an isomorphism. S2 of Vi is isomorphic to S2 I as a module over S2 I. So we are going to construct a family of algebras, which will be the deformation of this algebra, and which depend on one parameter. Okay, so how we proceed? We can write down now the commutator. So G0 is SL2 as here, and G1 is a module over SL2 plus SL2 plus SL2. And I just have to say, we have to define the bracket of what the elements, right? We have to define this.
I is the standard i-dimensional representation.
Two-dimensional.
No, they're all two-dimensional. Okay.
They're all two-dimensional. Sorry. The algebra which I'm going to get in the end is going to have dimension 90, 3 SL2, and 2 Q8, right? So what I can do, it's pretty clear what I'm going to do. I can take two vectors here, where went to SL2, and then take the forms on two others. So it's going to be the sum by J is not equal to K. The following thing, DJ, double DJ, this is the number, DK, double DK, which is the number, and then psi I, of Vi, Wi. So my summation, So my summation has three terms. And in each term, I'm going to put a parameter Ti. So you have The operation depends on three parameters, T1, T2, T3.
So, IJK are distinct?
Yes, IJK. I can write it in a longer form, but it basically means, I say, V2, W2, V3, W3, T1, V1, W1, times T1, plus C1. Okay? But I have to check also the Jacobi identity, and that gives me, and this is, of course, I'm not going to do it on the board. It's again an exercise. Check that Jacobi identity. Works for if T1 plus T2 plus T3 equals 0. Okay? So I get a super algebra. But of course, it is very easy to see. I can rescale. If I multiply all three parts, so maybe I should write down first. But they constructed a family of algebras. D21, T1, T2, T3 is a super algebra if T1 plus T2 plus T3 equals 0. It's also pretty clear, but if I multiply it by constant, it's going to be the same super algebra, isomorphic super algebra.
But I don't understand. Isn't this OSP for two?
No, it is not OSP42. OSP42 is just a member of this family.
Which one?
Okay, I'm going to tell you, this is the next. It's just D21, 1, 1, minus 2, okay, yeah. Yes. It's isomorphic to OSP42. So also, of course, you do the permutation, you still get any permutation, right? So I said I'm up to D21, T sigma 1, T sigma 2, T sigma 3. For any permutation, sigma in S3. Get the algebra which depends on the parameter which lies in P1, right? Because it's orthoproportional analysis. So we get something like 2, 1, A, or A actually, P1, quotient by the action of this group, permutation group, as well. Therefore, they also can compute the parameters. It's a deformation. And all the terms of this deformation are going to be simple, except if T1, T2, T3 is not zero, the algebra which we get is going to be simple. So it is kind of useful if you never work with these super algebras to see what happens when say T1 equals 0.
If I don't do it.
I cannot do it, I just don't care. So it's kind of interesting. What happens when T1 is 0? Okay. So then you have an idea. T1 plus SL2 plus SL2
three, remember, because the first copy doesn't appear. I never, yeah. So this is an ideal. Guys, I don't know how to.
Sorry, I think that this A,
yes.
This A is not in P1.
P1?
It is, because I can...
P1 plus
so
P2 plus
T3 is
0.
It is in P2, but you have the condition T1 plus T2 plus T3 plus 0.
Okay, right.
And you model by the scaling. Okay. So it's exactly P1, but actually it's P1 closure by action.
By the action.
So if you look at the idea here, these ideals isomorphic to another PSL, to two which we discussed before. Look, it has two copies of S2, and we have an A-dimensional representation of G1, which is going to be. So you have an ideal isomorphic to PSL to two, and that is another surprise, because now you can prove that PSL derivations of the separate algebra PSL to 2 is exactly this table 1. You can pick up any one. So again, what we see here that we have a huge group of derivations. So there are two more super algebras. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, there is no E8 or E7. So the only there is two more exceptional super algebras.
It's an ideal of B2 1 0 1 minus 1.
Uh-huh.
And the quotient?
The quotient is SO2. Sorry. Mm-hmm. It's actually same direct product of SO2 and I.
So the fact that the derivatives of PSL are D, is it obvious? I mean.
Oh, no, no, it is a construction. You have to prove that there is no more. No, it's not obvious. It's all some work. Okay. But okay. If I only do this work, I never.
No, no. I just to know.
Yeah.
So, excuse me, these deformations here are part of what you call classical?
They're called. Okay. So they're called basic exceptional right
basic
now.
Basic exceptional.
Yeah, the terminology is still, but I think now it's sort of linked to basic exceptional.
Okay.
Basic classical, basic exceptional, strange. I will give you two more basic exceptional super algebras. So original notation of Victor was G3 and F4, but this is not very good because there is one F4 which is a usual algebra. So I prefer to call them AG2. And AB3, and I will explain in a moment. So the idea of construction of these two algebras, it's just going to be the construction, and the construction is very simple. So it follows this following general pattern. Suppose you have G0 is a sum of two simple algebras, L1 plus L2. And suppose G1 is a tensor product of two reducible representations, which is over L1 and L2, which is going to be reducible over this. So
M1. M is a simple M1 module, and N is a simple M2 module. Maybe some parameter lambda here, which is essential to you. Y1, y2, phi, and x1, x2. So what is phi? Phi is the map from S2 of M to L1, and psi is the map of lambda to L1. So it is clear that this is an invariant map. So the result is an L1 plus L2. And that this is an invariant map.
Again, what is here?
Okay, so it's green. So I have a map therefore. Since L1 is a submodule of S2L.
So it's kind of projection.
Ah. Projection, right. Exactly. It's a projection, right. Psi phi S2 of M to A1. And psi is lambda of M to A2. So it is clear that what I constructed satisfy all conditions but the last one. For the last one, it's almost never satisfied. All the examples will be satisfied, there's already listed examples of OSP. And plus two examples here. In the first example here, G0 is SO2 plus G2. And M.
P is a parameter.
T is a parameter, right? In principle, you have a freedom here, right? Choice of this scale.
Yes, and Y1, Y2, so those are Y and Y prime. The index is 1 and 2 are given.
Oh, sorry. Excuse me, please. Y prime.
Okay.
Y prime. Excuse me. And it will be tired, sorry. Okay. So the only thing place when it works actually is not so many. And here we have AG2. So it's SL2 and an exception in the algebra G2. And the representations is the tensor product of the smallest possible representation. Two-dimensional representation for SL2. And what is the smallest dimensional representation of G2? Seven, right? So it's, I call it V7, seven dimensional representation. And the second example here, G0 is SO2 plus the algebra will be 3, which is O7, plus O7. And M is again V2, and M. So if I put the standard representation, I'm going to come back to the superalgebra OSP72. But there is one other small representation for OSP72. And this is a spinor representation. So this is a spin 7, which is of dimension 8. What 8? Okay. So this is the list of all superalgebras, which is so-called basic superalgebras.
And what about the parameters in this case?
D to 1 alpha, usually considered as exceptional one. D to 1
and 1 a. And it's for certain values of parameters.
What about?
Both
T.
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 What is T?
A T you choose. It's only one T.
But so in these two examples, it will be a number.
Ah, yes, but I don't remember. It's all depends on, I can't give you the number right now, right? Because these guys are defined up to scalar. Everything is defined up to scalar. So maybe I should remove T. It maybe becomes clear that there's only one T. Or maybe I should leave T, but I should say that there's only one T which makes into a superalgebra. Okay?
So if I just clarify, there are four isomorphic classes in this case. The 4, D3, F4, there's one simple list of the algebra.
When only one simple list of the algebra, here only one, there is one parameter family.
Right, so there's an infinite number of D, 2, 1.
Yeah, there, you see, the problem is that here you have three parameters really. And that's only the situation when you have three parameters up to projectilization, two parameters, and you have a choice of deformation.
Okay.
Here you do not have deformation, no deformation. So maybe I can start.
So all these exceptional, there is always a simple.
Yes. And what? I don't know why. Actually, I know why, but I'm not going to prove it in this class. I can refer you to original Richter paper or Schoenert wrote some detailed review of Richter's proof. So I wanted to give you an exercise to check that this construction works only in these cases. It is doable, but it is a work exercise. You can check, but if you look at such superalgebras, you can see that there is no others. Just because what breaks in this construction is Jacobian identity for three odd elements. Okay. So, what I'm going to do next, I'm going actually to develop the representation theory of basic superalgebras first. Why? Because many methods of usual representation theory will work in this case for these superalgebras as well. And in particular, the most powerful method is involving root, weights, while group, and all these. So I'm going to start, and I'm just going to start the roots theory. I'm going to be brief over it. I'm just going to tell that there are certain things which are new comparing to the classical theory. But the most important thing which you already should see is that even finite dimensional representations are not completely reducible anymore, as we already have seen. For example, because a simple least superalgebra has a central extension which is not split extension. So therefore, representation in this central extension is not completely reducible.
Assume
that So we started defining the Cartan subalgebra exactly in the same way as in the usual case. But what I'm concerned with is its normalizer. So the first fact, which for example you can check case by case, is that H coincides with its even part. So it's really Cartan subalgebra, which is zero.
What does it mean, Cartan
subalgebra? Cartan subalgebra is in the usual case, important. Coincides with this normalizer, right?
And so you're saying that that you can prove that it must be used.
At least in this case. There is one case where it is not so, but it's strange algebras. I'm not touching them. I'm going to talk about them.
Is the Q, right?
Q, exactly. Right. But
it's interesting.
Okay, so just an even part. So we give an example of JSLMN or JLMN. And in this case, H is just there. And that's again requires a proof, but for example, can be checked case by case, the dimension of each root space is either 1, 0 or 0, 1. And this allows me to define either parity on roots.
Except for
people.
Except for PSA.
Yeah, right. And it's even written in my notes. Except of PSA too. You already had an idea, but this is somewhat interesting. So pure algebra, but I will explain in a moment how maybe next time I'll give you. So what are the roots? I mean, probably should finish here, should stop here. So the roots are just the usual vectors in a complex vector space. This complex vector space is equipped with the form. What is the main difference with the usual root system? Is that in the usual root system, if you restrict it on the lattice generated by roots, it's going to be a positive form. Here it is not going to be positive. So parity is clearly defined as a function of this set of vectors. So even odd, right? So maybe just give you an example
What happens in the case of S element?
But what is exactly?
For all the three elements.
What is the, what is, I don't understand, what does not hold for S element?
No, because simple roots are linearly dependent.
The dimension of G alpha is 2, 0. Dimension of G alpha is 1, 0, or 0, 2 for PSL 2.
Everything else holds.
Everything else holds, and I'm going to explain it next time. Maybe just say a few words. I have to stop, so I just say a few words. So there is this general machinery of Krasmuti algebras, which can be easily generalized for super algebras. So as we know from Victor Kass' book, that finite dimensional Lie algebras corresponds positive definite non-degenerate Cartan matrices. What happens for super algebras? Sometimes the Cartan matrix of a finite dimensional Lie super algebra is already degenerate. So in a way, it is like a fine Lie algebra. So what we have to do in order to construct a suitable representation theory, we should add the center and the gradient element as we do for affine super algebras. We should add the center. Why it is better to work with GL2 instead of PSL2, what I actually will spend some time on explaining this example next time. So next time I plan to do finite dimensional representation theory. And maybe do completely the case of GLMN, at least the statements, while Cartan, use finite dimensional Cartan theory for GLMN. Thank you.